Farmington United Methodist Church, where we help ordinary people become spiritually thriving servants of Christ for the sake of the world. I'm so happy to see all of you today, and I'm so glad that you're here with us now. Just a couple quick announcements. First of all, if you are interested in serving on the prayer ministry, check out the newsletter, the Farmington United Methodist newsletter that should have gone to your email, or you can go to our website and find it, or on the church Facebook page. Go there, and that will tell you ways that you could help serve on our prayer ministry. We are looking for people who just want to talk to God on behalf of our church, and there's different ways that you could do that. So anyway, check that out. The other announcement I have this morning is that our summer read program starts tonight. And so that's where the church is all right, we've got some whoops, and all right, terrific. If that's something that interests you, where a bunch of people are all going to read the same book together, a spiritual book, and they're going to go through it at the same time, and they're going to discuss it, and maybe you haven't signed up yet, you forgot, you could just show up tonight. And that's going to be at 7:30. Show up here at the church, and you can get in on that discussion, okay? So anyway, with that, I'm going to pray. We're going to do the children's message after the worship songs this morning, okay? And let's pray together. Lord, I thank you for this day. I thank you for this morning that you created. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. There are people who have walked in these doors who are facing challenges. They're carrying burdens. There are things on their heart and in their mind. There's things that are eating away at their gut. I pray that each of us could set those things aside and just simply focus on you, the creator and the author of life. Let us do that for this 1 hour and see what you have to tell us. See what you have to do that's going to move in our lives. But help us to worship you. Please drown out the noise of the world for just this hour, God, and be with us now. I thank you for the praise team who's going to lead us in that worship. I pray you'd bless each one of them. And I ask all these things in the name of Christ. Amen. Now, if you're able and wanting to, please stand and we'll worship together.
Built and nothing less. How is it?
Good morning, everybody. Have a seat. All right. Who are you? All right, nice to see all of you. So I've been going here for a really long time, and I've noticed something about you guys. You just keep getting bigger. Right? You keep getting more mature, right? You keep going up in grades, and that's not going to stop. And there's something very special that's going to happen to you when you get into high school, okay? And that is that here at the church, actually it's junior high, I should back up, it's in junior high. Here at the church, you're going to get to be a part of the youth group. Are you excited about that? Yeah, I see a lot of people nodding and hands waving. Good. Yeah, that is pretty darn exciting. And they do all kinds of things. They have fun activities. They have fun games. They have weekly youth group meetings. But they also do some really cool trips, right? And our youth are leading today on a youth trip. And they are going up to Old Forge, New York. They're going to be camping there. They're going to go to a water park. They're going to take a mountain hike. They're doing all sorts of fun stuff. I thought it might be really cool if you all could help send them off, okay? And what I mean by that is we're going to pray for them. Yes, Danielle?
I have to go mom.
Yep, your brother's going, isn't he?
Yeah.
Shay's going to go. That's right. And your sister's going. All right. That's her introduction to the youth group, isn't it? Well, I hope they're nice to her. My son Stephen wants to go. Would that be okay with you, Tammy? Yeah. Would that be all right? We have a few others too, if you'd like to take them. In fact, their bags are packed. We were hoping that, right on cue, buddy. Okay. So you're going to help us send them off. What I mean by that is you're going to help us pray for them. And we want them to have a really fun time. We want them to have a time that they will never, ever forget. But we also want them to have a time where they get to reflect on their relationship with Jesus. That is the most important thing. We hope that there's quiet time, that there's time that God speaks to their heart, and that they grow closer to Jesus after going on the trip than they did before going on the trip. Wouldn't that be fun? That would be really cool. That's what it's all about. So I'm going to have the youth leaders and the kids that are going to Old Forge today come on up here, and all of us are going to help send you off. Tammy, did you have anything you wanted to say? Or Kevin, did you have anything you wanted to say before?
Just pray all week long, please. No rain.
They don't want rain. They don't want to lose any kids, right? Okay, so, yep. Here, Danielle, move over so your brother can get by. There you go. All right. Now, I'm going to ask for three prayer requests, other than the rain one. We already heard that. Three prayer requests. Any of the teenagers, you can yell out. Give me one. What would one be? We learned to speak, that we learned it, we're able to talk.
Long, quiet week.
Throw them out, or we want to know what to pray for?
Safety,
that's a great one. Yes, we pray for your safety. Andrew?
Growing closer to God,
yes, that's terrific. One more. That's right. Okay, you can't go, nobody's going. A lot of fun. Okay, those are three great ones. Safety, grow closer to God, and that they'd have a lot of fun. I think those are terrific prayer requests. Tammy?
And I survive.
What do you guys think? Is she going to survive?
Yeah,
you think so? She has survived already, spent many years here, so I think you're going to do okay on this trip. But guys, isn't this a wonderful big group of teenagers going on the trip? Isn't that fantastic? So great job, youth leaders. Kevin, Tammy, and Taryn, are there any other leaders?
Junior leader Carly.
Junior leader Carly. Thank you, Carly, for coming along.
And Tony
Montone is going to be there, too. And he's hiding out in his truck in the fetal position. Just not sure. Anyway, let's, congregation, you join us in prayer as well as we, as the kids here pray for them. Lord, thank you for today. It's a big special day as the youth group take off on a trip together. So we pray for three major things. One, we pray for their safety. We ask that nobody would get hurt and everybody would be well. And nobody would get sick either, Lord. Please protect them. Protect them spiritually and protect them physically. And God, we pray for them to have lots of fun. I hope that this is a trip of a lifetime, one that they'll never forget, and one that helps them grow closer to each other. So Lord, we pray for them to have a great time. And God, my personal favorite thing to pray for is that they would each grow closer to you on this trip. Because if they don't, then it was no different than any other trip they could go on. A school trip, or a band trip, or a club that they're involved with. It's no different than those. We want to be different, God. And we ask that this is a trip where they grow closer to you. They go from point A to point B in their relationship with Jesus. So we pray that would happen in the hearts of each and every teenager going, and also in the leaders. And so I ask these three things in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, teens, you can go back to your seats. And kids, you can go back to yours. And thank you for your help. I really appreciate it. And you're all going to be there someday. I was listening to that last praise song, Graves into Gardens. I realized that in some ways there's a line in there that sums up my entire message this morning. And you're probably thinking, yeah, gee, just give us that line and we'll go home. But the line was this. It says, man's empty praise and treasures that fade is never enough. And then it goes on to sing, there is nothing better than you. And that's what we're going to talk about this morning. You know, we can all look back in times in our lives where we were confronted with stark choices, right? I think one of the first really big choices that I had to make was when I graduated high school. I had determined that I wasn't going to go to college at that point. And I had two choices on my plate. One was the dream that I had had since I was in fifth grade, or excuse me, I was 5 years old. I was 5 years old, and I saw the movie Ten Commandments on television, right? And the next morning, my mom came downstairs into her living room to find me standing up on her coffee table, wearing her bathrobe, and holding a staff in my hand. And the staff was a rake, not a garden rake, not a leaf rake. Does anybody know what that rake might have been for? Now it was 1975. Shag carpeting, that's right, Mike. That's right. We had to rake the shag carpeting whenever we had company in order to make sure it all went in one direction. Isn't that funny? My son doesn't even know what I'm talking about, but my mom would say, Dan, go rake the carpet. We got company coming over. And I wanted to be Moses. And that's not what my dream was. I wasn't dreaming to be a prophet someday when I graduated high school. But from the time I was five on, when I saw that movie with Charlton Heston, I wanted to be an actor. That was my whole dream in life. And my whole plan up into the last semester of high school, my senior year, was that I was just going to pack up my car and I was going to drive to California. And I was sitting in youth group one night and I felt this tug on my heart, a voice clear in my heart that said, don't do that, go into youth ministry. And I don't know, looking back on it, I'll be honest with you, I don't know if that was really the voice of God to my heart. I don't know if I was just simply scared, you know, frightened to leave the world that I knew in my small town of Honeyeye Falls, right up the road. I don't know if I was just nervous that I drove a red vet. I didn't know if it was going to make it. It was a Chevette, but I didn't know. I didn't know if it was going to make it to California with all my belongings. And I was confronted with a choice. Do this, your dream of all those years, or do that, go into youth ministry. And I can remember just a few years later, at college time, that I was offered two jobs. One was to go on staff for Young Life in New Jersey. And my Young Life leader had set up the interview for me. And I was offered the job. And that same exact weekend, I was offered my first church youth ministry job at the Penfield United Methodist Church. And I chose the Penfield United Methodist Church. But it was a hard, stark decision. And we are often confronted with those things. You know, I had to make the decision whether to marry Elizabeth or not. You know, whether to propose. And of course, I chose wisely, right? And today we're going to look at a time where the disciples were confronted with a great choice. And it's the same choice that God has been offering everyone since the very beginning, since the Garden of Eden. It's really a choice between life and death, and he offered that choice all the way from the garden, through the Old Testament, all the way to the cross, and all the way beyond the cross, to right where we are sitting right here, right now, the choice between life and death. And each one of us here right now are being offered that choice. And I'm talking about spiritual life and spiritual death. In Deuteronomy, there's a verse that lays this choice out beautifully in chapter 30, verses 19 to 29, where it says, "This day I call heaven and earth as witnesses against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life, so that you and your children may live, and that you may love the Lord your God. Listen to his voice, and hold fast to him, for the Lord is your life. And he will give you many years in the land he swore to give to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." Just laid out so beautifully. The choice is life and death, curses and blessings. You know, back in the early 2000, and about 2000 actually, well, okay, in the early 2000, there was a type of music that came on the scene, and it lasted for about 3 or 4 years, and I don't know if you even remember this type of music, but it was called rapcore. And some people called it new metal. That was another description for it. And in 2000, on March 7th, there was a song released by a rapcore band called Papa Roach. And if I ever heard a song that so clearly represented the path of death, then this popular song that made it into the top 10, then I don't know what it is. And I'll read the lyrics to you. It says, "Cut my life into pieces. I've reached my last resort. Suffocation, no breathing. I don't give a bleep if I cut my arm bleeding. Would it be wrong, would it be right if I took my life tonight? Chances are that I might. Mutilation's out of sight and I'm contemplating suicide. Because I'm losing my sight, losing my mind, and somebody would tell me I'm fine. I wish somebody would tell me I'm fine. Nothing's all right. Nothing is fine. I'm running and I'm crying. I never realized I was spread too thin till it was too late and I was empty within. Hungry, feeding on chaos and living in sin. Downward spiral, where do I begin? It all started when I lost my mother. No love for myself, no love for another. searching to find a love upon a higher level, finding nothing but questions and demons. I can't go on living this way. What a depressing, hopeless song. But yet it probably summed up hundreds of thousands of teenagers at the time, and maybe teenagers even today, who feel that kind of emptiness, that kind of hopelessness, that lostness. And it was a top 10 song. And yet it so clearly represents that choice that God has offered us from the beginning to now. The choice of either life or a death like that, a spiritual death. Now thankfully, about a year later, another rap core band came on the scene with a song. On July 31st, 2001, and it happened to be a rap core band where each of the members know Jesus Christ. And I can't think of a better song from that time that more clearly represents life, the choice that God gives us of life. And so band POD, and they had a song called Alive. And I want to read these lyrics to you so you can understand the great contrast between death and life as offered in the Bible. Every day is a new day. I'm thankful for every breath I take. I won't take it for granted, so I learn from my mistakes. It's beyond my control. Sometimes it's best to let go. Whatever happens in this lifetime, so I trust in love. You have given me peace of mind. If I feel so alive, I feel so alive for the very first time. I can't deny you. I feel so alive. I feel so alive for the very first time, and I think I can fly. Sunshine upon my face, a new song for me to sing. Tell the world how I feel inside, even though it might cost me everything. Now that I know this, so beyond I can't hold this. I can never turn my back away. Now that I've seen you, I can never turn my back away. Now that I know you, I can never turn my back away. And now that I see you, I can never turn my back away. And now that I know you, I can never turn my back away. And now that I see you, I believe that no matter what they say, I feel so alive. I'm so thankful that song came out when it did to contrast the other. It was also a top 10 hit. And it beautifully fits into our scripture passage this morning. Our morning text is from John chapter 6. And at this time, John chapter 6, you know, we think of the disciples as the 12, right? The 12 disciples. But in this passage, it indicates that at one time, there were a whole bunch of disciples. And there were a whole bunch of people, students, and people following Jesus around the countryside. And he gets to a point in his ministry where he starts preaching some tough stuff. He starts telling them about the keys to eternal life. He talks about him being the bread of life, and you have to eat of him in order to live. He says that no one can come to the Father except through him. And he's talking all of this tough stuff. And then we get into verse 60 of chapter 6 of the book of John. And this is the saddest verse. This is what it says. It says, on hearing it, many of his disciples said, this is hard teaching. Who can accept it? And aware that his disciples were grumbling about this, Jesus said to them, does this offend you? Then what if you see the Son of Man ascend to where he was before? The Spirit gives life. The flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you, they are full of the Spirit and life. Yet there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus had known from the beginning which of them did not believe and who would betray him. And he went on to say, this is why I told you that no one can come to me unless the Father has enabled him. And this is the other part of the sad verse. It says, from this time on, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him, because he was speaking hard truths. They were offended. That's what Jesus said. He said, are you offended? And they turn and they walk away. And so Jesus, he turns to the 12. He says, you do not want to leave too, do you? And Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God. To whom shall we go? When I read this text, I realized there were about 5 or 6 different messages I could do today. But I narrowed it down to these 2 themes. The first one is this crowd who gets offended and they leave Jesus. And I'm wondering, are there hard truths today that might turn people away? And my fear is, with the modern church and our Western culture, that the answer would be no. And the reason my answer is no is because I'm afraid that the church has become so watered down, so wussified in its message, that it's not going to offend anybody. I mean, everybody is trying to make it seeker sensitive, and let's make sure we don't offend anybody, and let's not preach on these passages because, oh, they might get upset. We'll just preach on love and tolerance. We'll just preach on that stuff. We don't want to offend anybody. And we have made it in our church today that the worst sin could be that we offend somebody. Was Jesus worried about offending anybody? Nope. Turns the ones who stayed. He said, how about you guys? You gonna go too? He didn't chase them down the street. Wait! Come back! You heard it wrong. Let's have a conversation. No. But let me ask you this. Let's personalize. Are there hard truths that if you read them in the Bible or somebody preached them to you, would you turn away because it was too tough to hear? What I'm afraid that I see now in our culture are so many people who call themselves Christians, but what they have really done is made God in their image, and then they worship that God passionately. They worship that God fervently and religiously, but they're not following the God of the Bible. They're not following the Jesus of Scripture. That's one of my fears. So that's the one theme that I get. Is that the crowds will cut and run when things get tough to hear. Dwight L. Moody once said, if I walk with the world, I can't walk with God. We are called to be aliens and strangers here, foreigners in a strange land. That's what the Bible calls us. Where else would we go? And I think that question is a sign of spiritual maturity. I think when you can ask that question, you know, God, life is tough. I'm dealing with some garbage. There's things going on in my life. But if you can ask yourself, well, God, where else am I going to go? That's a sign of spiritual maturity. So the other message from this morning is I want to ask you to use your imaginations for a moment. I want you to think back to your life before Jesus. Now, some of you might not be able to do that because you were raised in a Christian home by parents that taught you about the Lord, and you just sort of always kind of believed it for yourself. And that's fantastic. And so I'm going to ask you to use your imagination in a different way. And the question is, where would your life be without Jesus? Where would your life be without Jesus? See, I might have taken a little red vet, driven it out to the West Coast, and got myself involved in the cesspool of Hollywood. These people that we listen to for some odd reason. You know, I read that the West Coast has more cosmetic plastic surgery than anywhere else in the country. And yet those folks are miserable. And yet for some reason we put some kind of weight and stock into what the movie stars tell us or the TV stars tell us. And we even put them before Congress sometime to testify about things they don't know anything about. Is that where we would turn without Christ? Would we turn to our athletes? People who make millions upon millions upon millions of dollars who can't relate to any single person in this room. And yet they will scold you on how it is that you're supposed to live your life. And they will take money and they will perform their athletics. I say perform, that's how much of an athlete I am. They will compete in China, of all places, the biggest human rights abusers in the world. They'll take money, they'll take millions, it's okay, but I'm going to scold you about how you live. I'm going to tell you what you should think. Are we going to put our trust and hope in them? Is that who we're going to follow if we don't follow Jesus? Are we going to follow our friends, our family? Are we going to put our hope and trust in relationships? Remember that praise song this morning said, man's empty praise and treasures that fade is never enough. It will never satisfy. Will we put our hope and trust in money and drugs and alcohol? What would it be that we would follow if we weren't following Jesus right here, right now? There was once a... Well, I was thinking some people, they put their faith and their hope in politics and politicians. There was once a cartoon that said, the rat race is over, the rats have won. Probably how a lot of people feel, right? Are we going to put our faith and hope and trust in those people? Or are we going to put it in Jesus, the hope that never fades? That choice is life. Those other choices can bring you death if they're apart from Jesus. You know, I know I'm preaching to the choir. Most of you here have made that choice, that life choice to follow Jesus. You haven't turned around. Even when you hear tough stuff, you haven't turned away from God. You may not understand it all. Hey, if I was God, if I was in charge, I would make different rules. But I'm not. And having a faith in Jesus is about having faith outside of yourself. Not your own whims and dreams and desires. And, you know, not to set up a God made in your image, but to worship the God who made you in his image. Most of you, though, you've made that life choice, but there might be somebody sitting here who has made the choice for spiritual death. And you're living in that, you're struggling in that, and you're wallowing in that. I want to encourage you this morning as I close with this. This is a story that I read. It's in a writing by Maurice Chalfant. In a piece called The Advocate, and it's called Don't Give Up. It says, there is a painting that shows the devil at a chessboard with a young man. And the devil has just made his move, and the young man's queen is checkmated. And on his face is written defeat and despair. And one day, the great chess genius, Paul Morphy, he stood looking at the painting. And he studied carefully the position on the board. And suddenly his face lit up and he shouted to the young man in the painting, you still have a move. Don't give up. You still have a move. And we come to those moments when it seems we are checkmated. We see no winning move that we can make. You ever feel that way? You feel like all your options are over, there is no more move that you could make. You feel defeated in life. It says, then the great master of all life comes closer to us He remembers one day when he prayed to be spared from the cross. "Let the cup pass from me," he pleaded. The cross seemed the end of the world. But there was yet another move. Beyond the cross was an empty tomb and victory. That same Christ can see beyond your cross to some triumph. Don't give up. You still have a move. Jesus says that. So this morning, ask yourself the question, "Lord, where else would we go?" And ponder that this week. Let's pray. Lord God, I thank you that you have laid out the choice so clearly for us. It's a choice between death and life, a choice of a life with you, or, Lord, a life without you. That really is hopeless and meaningless. I pray for everybody in this room that they would make that life-giving, life-affirming choice. Lord, I pray for people who are our enemies, people who live and wallow and breathe in death all day long. I pray for them too, even. I pray for our neighbors, for our coworkers, for people who, for our friends too, Lord, people who simply don't know you in the life that you bring. I lift them up to you now and I ask that you would enter their hearts and bring them life. God, I thank you that you have given us that new life in Christ. I pray that when the truths get tough, when the scriptures of the Bible are hard to hear, they're hard to listen to, they're hard to understand sometimes, I pray that you would give us the strength not to turn away, but that we would stay with you, because God, where else would we go? I ask all this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
You are my joy, you are my
us read the closing scripture together from Colossians chapter 2, verse 8. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the basic principles of this world, rather than on Christ. Now let us receive the benediction. Father, go with us now as we exit this church, and let that be our mission field. And Lord, may we never, ever, ever give up on following you. And I pray you would bless us and keep us all the days of our lives, and make your face to shine down upon us. In the name of Christ, amen.